Hey, what's going on? My name's Robert, and you are watching Southpaw Autoworks. This video is going to be all about the 4L60E shift solenoid. The 4L60E is equipped with two of these bad boys. The valve body's got the 1-2 shift solenoid, as well as the 2-3 shift solenoid. And if you didn't already know, sometimes these solenoids are also referred to as shift solenoid A and shift solenoid B. During the course of this short video, you're gonna get an inside look at the 4L60E shift solenoid. We'll be identifying each of the components that make up the solenoid, and we'll be learning what each of those components does. Additionally, we'll be looking at how the solenoid operates as a whole. And to take things a step further, we're gonna be learning about the impact that the shift solenoid has on the 4L60E valve body. If you are as excited about this video as I am, please do me a solid and hit that like button. It really does help. Without further ado, let's get this show on the road. Here's the solenoid fully disassembled. Let's go through each of the components, starting on the left side. We've got the solenoid snout. This is the inlet for the oil going into the solenoid. Some come equipped with this metal screen and some do not. If we look at the other end of the snout, we can see that it has a little seat. This is for the metering ball. This is the metering ball. It's basically the internal valve within the shift solenoid. More on that in a minute. This is the metal plate. The metal plate has several holes in it. Two of those holes are for the dowel pins that are built right into the solenoid snout. And the center hole acts as a guide for the plunger, which we're gonna get to here in a second. This is the spring, and we're gonna get to what the spring does here shortly. This is the plunger. The plunger happens to have an iron core in it. And as we already know, iron can be influenced by a magnetic field. And we'll see the importance of that coming up shortly. This plastic housing provides a home not only for the plunger, but it also provides a home for the coil assembly. And this is the metal frame that holds all of the solenoid components together. To get a better understanding of how the solenoid works, let's get rid of everything and start with just the plunger and this plastic housing. The plunger lives within the plastic housing. The coil that lives on the plastic housing, whenever it becomes energized by the PCM or the 4L60E computer, whenever that coil becomes energized, it creates an electromagnetic field. Another word for an electromagnet. And that electromagnet acts on the plunger, moving the plunger to the left. Whenever the coil is de-energized, the plunger moves to the right. And of course, it needs the assistance of the spring, which we'll get to here in a second. So again, coil energized, plunger moves to the left. Coil de-energized, plunger moves to the right. So let's introduce the spring and the plate. So the spring actually lives down inside of the plunger, and that spring pushes the plunger to the right. Now we energize the coil, and the plunger moves to the left against spring pressure because the magnetic force pushing the plunger to the left is greater than the resistance provided by the spring. When the coil is de-energized, the plunger moves to the right because of the spring tension. So once again, coil energized, plunger moves to the left. Coil de-energized, the plunger moves to the right because of the spring. Let's introduce the metering ball. The metering ball lives within this location. As the coil is energized, the plunger moves to the left and the plunger moves the metering ball. And of course, as the coil is de-energized, the plunger moves back to the right. And the ball moves back to the right too, and what pushes the ball is the flow of oil, which we'll get to in just a second. So again, coil energized, plunger and metering ball move to the left. Coil de-energized, plunger and metering ball move to the right. Switching gears real quick. According to my analytics, not a lot of you are subscribed. So if you're watching this video and it's adding value, be sure to subscribe and don't forget to hit that notification bell too, so you don't miss out on any future videos. Let's introduce the solenoid snout into the equation. As we already know, there's a passageway through the solenoid snout. At the far left, the passageway is very wide. But as it makes its way to the right, we can see that it steps down into a much smaller passageway. This is called the orifice. And at the end of the orifice, at the far right, we've got what's called a seat, a valve seat. So when the metering ball is pushed up against this seat, it creates a liquid and airtight seal. So as the coil is energized, the plunger and the metering ball move to the left. And they move far enough to the left that the metering ball is pushed firmly up against its seat, and now oil cannot escape past the metering ball. However, as the solenoid is de-energized, the plunger moves to the right. This allows the oil pressure to push the metering ball off of its seat, which enables the oil to exit the solenoid through the exhaust port. So once again, with the solenoid energized, oil flow is stopped at the solenoid. And with the solenoid de-energized, oil flow is able to exit the solenoid. At this point in the video, we've identified each of the components that makes up the shift solenoid. We've also learned how the shift solenoid permits the flow of oil or prevents the flow of oil. In the next segment of this video, we're going to take a closer look at the oil flow and discover the importance of it. With the ignition turned on and the engine still at rest, the ignition switch delivers 12 volts of electricity to the shift solenoid. At the same time, the PCM provides the shift solenoid with an electrical path to ground. This completes the electrical circuit, resulting in the shift solenoid being energized. We now know that whenever the solenoid is energized, that oil is not permitted to flow through the solenoid. However, at this point in time, there is no oil being supplied to the solenoid. This is because the engine is off. The 4L60E pump is indirectly driven by the engine. So when we fire up the engine, the 4L60E pump rotates at engine speed. This causes the pump to simultaneously suck fluid in and push fluid out. The oil is routed through the pump and pushed into the transmission case, where with the help of the separator plate, the oil jumps back and forth between the transmission case and the valve body a number of times before the oil ultimately comes into contact with the shift solenoid. Whenever the engine is running, oil is continuously fed to the shift solenoid. Seeing how the shift solenoid is energized and the internal valve is closed, this oil that keeps coming into this circuit now has nowhere to go. It's trapped. And as the oil becomes trapped, the oil starts to build pressure. With the trans in park and the engine idling, you could expect to see a pressure of right around 55 to 60 PSI. Under the right driving conditions, this oil pressure could reach a maximum of 115 PSI. So it's possible for this oil pressure to be anywhere from 55 PSI up to a maximum of 115 PSI and anywhere between those two values. However, as the shift solenoid is de-energized, the internal valve opens and it allows that oil to exhaust through the solenoid. And at this point in time, the oil pressure will drop down to zero. So once again, with the solenoid energized, we build oil pressure. With the solenoid de-energized, oil pressure drops down to zero PSI. This system works the way that it does thanks to the orifices. There's an orifice, of course, in the solenoid itself, and not pictured here, there's another orifice just upstream of the solenoid. That upstream orifice happens to be significantly smaller than the orifice located within the solenoid. The layout of these two orifices enable the circuit to exhaust oil a whole heck of a lot faster than the oil can be replenished. The key takeaway here is that the solenoid has the ability to create oil pressure just upstream of the solenoid, and the solenoid has the ability to exhaust all of the oil, resulting in no oil pressure upstream of the solenoid. The 4L60E valve body is equipped with three shift valves. The shift solenoids and the shift valves work together in order to create both upshifts and downshifts. I recently dedicated a video to the operation of the 1-2 shift valve and the 1-2 shift solenoid. Check out the video description for more information. On the surface, you've learned the basics of how the 1-2 and 2-3 shift solenoid operate. However, in my mind, it goes a lot deeper than that. Now that you're armed with this knowledge, it can enable you to make informed rebuilding decisions, and it can enable you to better diagnose your own 4L60E automatic transmission problems. I am super excited that we got the basics out of the way in this video. You now have an understanding of how the shift solenoid operates, so that means we can take things to the next level, and the next level in a future video, we'll be covering common problems with the shift solenoid that result in a number of 4L60E problems. So once again, if you haven't done so already, subscribe and hit that notification bell too, so you don't miss out on that upcoming video. Once again, my name is Robert, and I will see you next time.
I won't stop till I hear him say, oh, oh.